Latest episode of the Chirp with Daren Millard dropping right now with Ray Ferraro, analyst, former National Hockey Leaguer, and a guy that I think I can go almost anywhere with. This is one of the greatest ones. And we follow up last week's episode with Daren Pang, who at some point, my goal is to get Daren Pang and Ray Ferraro on at the same time. Would you be open for that, even though you're at two different networks now?
Now, Panger is one of my good buddies.
Yes.
We have been on several golf trips together. Mm-hmm. Somewhere along the line, the guys started calling us Harry and Lloyd from Dumb and Dumber. So I will give you this example. We're on the driving range at Bandon Dunes. If you've been to this beautiful resort, there's one road that goes through the middle of the resort, and all the golf courses are on the right. Panger and I realize as we're hitting balls, man, we're gonna be late for our tee time. So we jump in the car. I'm driving. We end up in the maintenance yard. There's no golf course there. So we turn around. Now we're screaming down. We're like, how did we do that? So now we're late. I drive in and we're rushing. I hit the little mini bumper curbs.
Yes.
So I go over top of one of those. I come screeching to a halt. We're in our rental car. We're like, oh boy. So we run out. We got our bags. We're running up. We run up the first tee. The guys are waiting. We're in a group of 20. So if you screw up your tee time, you've really screwed the deal up. We get there. We're on the tee. Panger runs up the tee. He's like, hey, Parm, have you got a golf ball? Like, he didn't have a ball. And I'm like, yeah, I got a ball. And I threw him a ball. I'm like, hey, do you have a glove? Like, we were so disorganized. We're on the same team. Oh man, he's the best. I love Panger.
the maintenance, we've all driven by golf courses, and the maintenance yards are nowhere near the first tee. Like, they're far away.
But there's five courses. Yeah. Just think, we're at the end of the road of five courses. We didn't even notice that we were chattering away, and we ended up in this literally a parking lot with a bunch of huge mowers in it.
I blame the leader of your group, whoever put that group together. And I know a few of the different people that are part of that little traveling party, because leaving the two of you alone is the first mistake.
Terrible mistake.
Yeah.
There are so many times that we're up on two wheels, the two of us, and somehow we kind of get it back on track just to make it in time. So leaving us together, when we room together, it's 50-50. We're making that tee. Well, we'll always make the tee time. It's whether we've got everything we're supposed to have when we get there.
My intended first question is now going to be at the end of the interview, because I do want to get to some hockey here. You're doing Sid and Ovi this week.
Yeah.
Have you done one of those games before?
No.
That's pretty incredible.
Yeah. Isn't it? What's incredible? Just think how long we've been talking about these two guys, Daren. Like, remember when they came in and, they were, going to revitalize the league. And
the hotel. Remember the hotel promo where they were pushing each other in the golf
and in the cart.
Yeah.
And like, they were so skilled and so different. And now we get all these years later, we're at this whole new crew of young guys. And here are these now older guys somehow. And they're still so amazing. They Sid's just hitting his gear now. I think he's got 13 points in 13 games. He's on a point run now. And Ovi's just it's like he scores every game. I can't believe he can still do this like he is. And then we see this week, Trevor Zegras flipped the puck over the net. And the guys that I'm amazed that they can do this stuff at the level they can, the young kids. And yet here are these two grizzled old guys now that still lead any team they're on. It's really remarkable.
Who do you like watching more? And it's a difficult question at ice level, because that perspective, Sid, Ovi.
I will say Ovi only because there's an unpredictability to his game. Mm-hmm. Like, he just might get really sour and run somebody from 15 feet. And to watch him shoot, I've done enough of his games and, when you see that one timer coming, there's almost this anticipation that it's going to be a missile. Yeah. And literally the sound it makes is different when it leaves his stick. And he's so enthusiastic. Like, I don't, I'm trying to think who scored their first goal this year. Was it Connor McMichael maybe? And
yeah,
Ovi like dove into the net and then dove on him. He's like, he's 15 years old. He's so exciting. When Sid goes by the, if I'm between the benches and he goes by and he's got open ice, that's something to watch. You know, it's not McDavid, but it's this power. It's like you get swept up in it. But I just think Ovi's just the most entertaining character. I mean, to watch, I really do. I love watching him play.
Do either one of them ever talk to you? Like give you a nod or?
Just a nod.
Yeah.
I don't know really either of them very well. I mean, there's some guys that, you know, will, you know, have a running conversation if you're there, or guys that say hi all the time. Like when I was in Toronto, you know, I was doing Leafs games a lot and Tyler Bozak was still here before the anthem. You know, he always stood beside me. We'd often chat about golf or, you know, where have you played? And hey, you were out in Arizona last week. Did you play? And talk about, you know, like I like guys like that, but I really try to stay out of their space. Cause I like, it's my workspace, but it's their bench, right? Like I'm kind of dropped in there. I don't like too much until they talk to me. Like, okay, last week, 2 weeks ago, I'm standing there, I'm doing a pre-period hit, and Pat Maroon picks up my notes. And so he's standing right beside me, but he's reading my notes to see what I've written about him on the notepad. And I'd written, you know, lost weight quicker this year, you know, 3 straight Stanley Cups. And so he looks and he kind of nods his head and he's like, oh, and he put it back. And, but I was like, what if I'd written something like, you know, terrible player or yeah, I don't know, something stupid like that.
No and hockey sense.
Yeah. And he's sitting there reading, he's reading my notes. And I'm, oh, I thought it was so funny. I love that stuff.
Would you have talked to the person between the benches when you played?
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
for sure. Yeah. I talked to everybody. I mean, like I talked to the linesmen. I talked to the refs. Sometimes it went well. Sometimes it didn't. I find the energy of the ice, like it's almost intoxicating to be there. That's why I think I love it there so much, is because you actually feel like you're in it. I mean, you're not, you're in a suit, but it feels like you're in it. It's the best place, I think.
What was your reaction to Zegras Milano?
Couldn't believe it. Could not believe a couple of things. A, that he had guts to do that in a game. B, that he actually thought of it in the game. Like, it's one thing, you know, when you're screwing around at practice, you try different things all the time, but he's behind the net. And apparently Milano communicates, you know, yells Michigan. And he's like, oh yeah, throws it over the net. Like, who's going to do that?
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. I wish people could watch things and enjoy it. Because if you look under the comments, you know, people are like, yeah, poor coverage by the Sabres. And, you know, Asplund should have tied up his stick. And I'm like, damn, it was amazing. On every play, the coverage could be better. It could be. Mm-hmm. But I know that there are times when something happens on the ice in a game and it just doesn't look right. And you kind of freeze for a second. You just kind of like, what? Oh, it's in the net. Like, you got to think, like, that happened in a second. That he just rolled his wrists over and flipped it over the net. And if Milano misses the puck, it's just a missed pass.
Right. I thought it was great because Milano waited for it to get below the crossbar. Right. There's no way I've got the patience. I'd be so excited to be,
that
I'd
it's
be
actually swinging coming, and hacking. Right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. For sure you would, because it would be so, you know, it's so rare.
Yeah.
Right. Like, you know, this is not normal that he's actually trying this. I love this kid's personality. Like, and you know what, Daren, I'd say 5 or 10 years ago, I wouldn't have appreciated it. And now I'm like, you know, he's bets Ryan O'Reilly $100 on a face-off. Well, the reason he did it was because he was like 32% on the draw. And O'Reilly, I don't know, what is he? He's always 60 plus, right? Yeah. And he's like, I'll bet you $100 on the draw. Like, could you imagine if you're O'Reilly? Like, what? You want to do what? And then he paid him, which is awesome. His personality, his flair, his style, We saw it at the World Juniors last year. Mm-hmm. And it was like, everything's a video game to a lot of these young guys. And the reason it is because their skill allows them to think of things that other players in the past just would have never even thought of.
Yet you and the era that that we came up in all had extra ice time and stuff. Is it the skill coach's influence or what is it?
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
it is for sure. And I don't know if you saw the little video from, so Zegras did that two nights ago.
Yeah.
And then the next day at practice, a couple of kids in Wisconsin at practice are trying it.
Yeah.
Like we would have never seen it back in the day if somebody had done it. Timo Solani tells an awesome story about, they used to have this play in Winnipeg his rookie year. Phil Housley would step out behind the net and Timo would go right between the defenseman and Housley would throw the pass right to the dot. And Timo would get it and boom, he'd be gone on a breakaway. He's like, yeah, nobody knew about it till March because there was no video. I was like, that's a good point. Like we would have got up to Winnipeg and like, where's he going? Oh, he's got a breakaway.
Yeah.
We would have never seen it.
Can't believe nobody got the CKND tapes from that.
Somebody should have put those together and rolled them down the hallway.
Yeah, the big canisters. I love the reaction. The comments, the coverage could have been better. But you mentioned 10 years ago. 10 years ago, the overwhelming reaction, I think, within our sport would have been show off or hot dog or whatever. I didn't get the sense of that. I thought it was pretty darn positive. And I think that's incredibly making progress.
Oh, I think the game is in a place of growth. Now, I'm biased, of course, because, you know, Don Granato's my brother-in-law. And, you know, I hope he does well in Buffalo. But I read a quote he had yesterday. And he's like, and I think this is the way the game is working, is that he said, look, we're not going to ignore our defense. But if we're in a bunch of 2-1 games, that means I'm stifling these guys' development. They need to develop with the puck. To win games, you need to have the puck. Eventually, you've got to have it. And when you have it, you've got to do something with it. And I thought, man, I would have loved to have played for coaches like that. But that wasn't our time. Our time was, you know, no drop passes at the blue line, get it out, get it in. Well, now you get up to the blue line, there's nothing there. You just turn back and hit. When you think about it, it makes so much sense. You've got the puck. We've worked so hard to get it. Why are we giving it to them?
Yeah.
Like all they do is say thanks. And then they start to attack us.
Is Anaheim not in the same boat sort of as Donnie and yes. Buffalo? Like they're going to win 6-5 games and they're going to learn with this group.
Two differences. John Gibson.
Yeah.
And, you know, in Buffalo's rolling through goalies, you know, I mean, they got to find somebody, although they just called up the guy they hope is their future in Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen.
He was in goal for that flipper.
Yeah. Just think, like, I'm sure. So he's like, well, where'd that come from? Right. But that's number one. And number two is like, you know, they've got Hampus Lindholm, who's, you know, a really good player, Josh, man. They've got some experience on the blue line, but it's offense. And I'm sure there are times the coaches are standing back there and just like, oh man, oh, good play. Right. You know, that happens all the time, but I think you've got to embrace it. You still build your structure, but you've got to embrace the skill. Otherwise you're asking these kids to, okay, bring your toolbox to the rink, dump out the left half and let's play with the rest of it. Like that makes no sense to me.
And it was the winning goal in a 2-0 game, the Milano goal.
Right.
It wasn't the sixth goal in a 7-2 game. So there's that. There, Kyle Wellwood, he did a between the legs play went back when he played. So that's how long ago. And I remember him sort of alluding to, he was kind of hesitant to go back to the bench because Pat Quinn was coaching. And we love Pat, but that was old school. And we've come a long way.
Go back to Thomas Hertl's goal against Marty Baron.
Yes,
I think it might have been Marty's last game, actually. Poor Marty, what a guy! And Hertl went in, he had two goals, and he went between his own legs, and scored. And there was a week long conversation about whether this was showing off. What he had a skill that other people didn't have. Who cares how you get it to go in the net? Like, if you can figure out a creative way. Who cares? There's lots of guys that go down and they got a 20-foot wrister and they hit the goalie, boom, right in the chest. Well, that's a good old-fashioned wrist shot. but didn't have any chance of going in. So I look at this, I could have never done it. I would have never tried it. No, Daren, I never tried it. I never practiced it. To shoot it between your own legs, I would have tripped myself. I got a penalty.
And then argued.
Argued myself on the way to the box.
I saw a game where it was the same night as Milano. Somebody made a between the legs behind the back pass to Austin Matthews. I can't remember.
Michael Bunting.
Yes. Then in another game, there was a between the legs tip in. I mean, how do you think of that?
I think that the reaction these guys have worked with their coaches, as you mentioned earlier, their skill coaches, they react to things. They train for unpredictability. We used to train in a sense, you get up to the red line, then you move it to the winger, then you go a center drive, then somebody comes over. It was very scripted. And now when you have the puck, there is no position. There is no set form. It's create and try and isolate a 2-on-1 somewhere. But wherever you isolate and get the 2-on-1 is all fine. Watch the D. I did the Columbus game the other night. The puck goes back from the corner to the left point to the defenseman for Columbus. And I look, and Werenski went around the other side all the way down by the net. Yeah. And then he didn't get the pass and he just kept coming back. I'm like, could you imagine a D in 1990 doing that? Not a chance.
No, unless your name was Leach or Coffee or
Bork. Three, four guys.
Yeah.
Cream of the crop.
And even now then they were back. They would lead
now,
rushes.
Now it's like, you got to go. You got to get people into the rush. I think the game's in a great spot for that.
On the subject of the game, have you ever wanted to be a manager?
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. But you can't just say, I want to be a manager and then start being a manager. You could be an assistant. You could be in hockey operations, but to think you could run an entire organization, you could be part of it and you could grow and learn while you get into it. But I've never had the chance. I've never had the conversation. I've never had an interview. So I just keep stumbling along doing what I'm doing. And I'm like, man, like Daren, this is 20 years. Yeah. I've been doing this. And what I thought was kind of a stopgap when I retired, because I didn't know. I was like, yeah, I want to stay in the game. And yeah, maybe this broadcasting will work. And then it's 20 years. And so I wouldn't be naive enough to think like I could just jump in and take over a team. Like you've got to get some. If I were a manager, I would say I would do it. It would be very collaborative.
Well, there's four openings right now. Four.
Yeah, there might need to be 14 more. I'm not pursuing anything. I like what I'm doing, but what I think the new way of management is the general manager is kind of the guy that stirs everything together. And then you help formulate what your direction is going to be. But the days of a general manager helping with scouting and helping with player development and then there's the business side. Like there's not enough hours in the day to do it correctly. There's also so many people that have specialized skills that if you're not taking advantage of those skills, you're falling behind. I think that's the new road of management.
You're close to the Vancouver situation because of geography. Were you surprised they did both?
No. I think what I was surprised because this is what it felt like living there. You're living in Vegas. You got a pulse on what's going,
exactly.
Right? It's a little different than looking from the outside. Travis Green and Jim Benning, it felt like for a few weeks, a month, were walking on a plank. And eventually they were going to get to the end of it, whether it was December or January or the end of the year. And it had spiraled into this negativity around the team, the players, and really neither guy could do their job. They could do it the best they could, but there was an inevitability to it. What surprised me though, Daren, was that they hired Bruce to coach with no one above him.
Right.
Because somebody is going to come in there, maybe two people, maybe four people, and you have a coach. the coach has to work with management and vice versa, and you're getting handed the coach.
Now, Bruce only signed a year and a half.
Next year, yeah.
Yeah.
So they're paying two coaches this year and next year.
Yeah.
And if you want to hire a third one, it's not your money. The manager or the owner has to say, yes, that's a good idea. Mm-hmm. But if Bruce goes in there and they've won a couple of games and they've, you know, they've got, they call it the, you know, the dead cat bounce, and they look energetic, they look quicker, they look like they're having more fun, which is Bruce's way.
Yeah, it's MO, you right?
I mean, that's just his way. And so maybe if they go on a decent run, you go, oh yeah, this is a great idea if you're the new manager. But eventually they're going to come to the point where their defense is still not going to be good enough, whether Bruce is the coach or Travis or somebody else. And you don't, as we all know, you can't fix a defense by next Thursday. You know, like there's a process to finding guys that can do enough that you don't get them through the draft. Like, where are you finding difference makers most times, unless they come in the draft? You're not Vegas that gets all of a sudden, geez, we can sign Petrangelo or we can sign Alec Martinez. But for the most part, you've got to, you know, it's your draft guys that are going to make a significant contribution for you.
What about Philly deciding to stay in house? That team puzzles me. I look at the talent.
See the highlights last night?
No, I didn't actually, because we played.
Daren, yeah. There was a goal last night. The defensemen were Sanheim and Ristolainen. There was a pass from the left sideboards. I even forget who they were playing, Jersey, to the right sideboards, to Jesper Bratt. And then he passed it all the way back through the same seam to the guy that scored. There were three Philly guys, including the two defensemen. I don't know what they were doing, like how the puck can go basically 150 to 60 feet across the same lane and nobody got a stick on it. Like they look lost. They really do. So I think it's a temporary move, but there's a lot of people under a lot of pressure in Philly right now.
Yeah, and I'm with you. Like the seam, that's all players try and stop is the seam pass.
Like, just put your stick down. I was always told, keep your stick on the ice, because even by accident, you might make a good play. And I was like, well, that's pretty good. You know, you have it down, you're looking at something, boom, puck hits your stick. Good play, I guess. But if it's up around your waist, it's no good for anything.
Yeah, I Philadelphia puzzles me. They were great a couple of years ago. Chuck went in there and sped up the process, and they were good. But I don't get it. And it's not just goaltending.
No, last year you could have said, oh, their goalies were so bad, it's tough to evaluate a team. This year, they've had injuries, and sure, but so does everybody else. But man, they just, you know, Couturier doesn't look right or impactful. You know, they lost Farabee. They've got guys that have had, Voracek for Atkinson. Yeah. They tried to fix their defense. They lose Ryan Ellis, which is a big loss. So there's lots of things probably that contribute to it, but they're nowhere near what I thought they were going to be.
Who's going to be Team Canada's goalie?
Oh gosh. It pretty clearly keep hoping for Carey Price. Yeah. I think that everybody's hoping for Carey Price, right?
Yeah.
They keep saying, hey, he skated 2 days. Did you see him skating? He's like going behind the net and fishing puck, you know, like stopping a rim.
No, it was the goalie school of T-push.
Yeah. And, yes, over to each post.
You know, the coach is holding the stick and pointing it left and right.
And he's got to be weeks away from playing. And they've got to make decisions really quick. I would find it hard that Mackenzie Blackwood's not part of it. I think he's really good. I mean, is Jordan Binnington going to be part of that?
I would think Price, so.
Price holds everything kind of, you know, he holds it up to see where exactly he is. If he can play, he's going to get the first crack at it for sure.
Yeah, I thought it was weird that Hockey Canada was putting out those videos of Carey Price back skating.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Look at this. See, everybody?
it's
I hope he's okay. I hope he's I hope he's feeling good about being back, you know, because it's one thing to get there. It's quite another to click your brain into the commitment to the work that you have to do. You know, like he can get out there and start like, I don't feel bad. No, not so bad. But then to really grind in is the next level for him. And he doesn't have a lot of time to get to the next level.
Be a hell of a story. And would it not be inspirational if he comes back and goes to the Olympics after spending time in the players' assistant program and coming off the injury? I think there'd be
on several levels.
Yeah.
Not just the hockey story, but the personal level. Yeah. And so many, you know, so many people looked at what he did and they said, I'm not Carey Price, but I feel like that too. Mm-hmm. And that is, I mean, I would say of the, all the, you know what, of the pandemic, one of the things that has become more common and more, more open is mental health. And I would say there's got to be very few people that can say they've breezed through these last 2 years and, right. and not found themselves in a pit somewhere.
Like you doing games off tube and kids and like, no matter what. Yeah, your
so,
style of life,
so Daren, right? Like for me, like it was great for us to be home together. That doesn't happen a lot. Mm-hmm. And we're lucky that we each had a, you know, Cammy had a work area. I had a work area to do, you know, do the games at you know, and the studio stuff. But even at home, it felt lonely. It felt dark. You'd look out on the street, nobody walking up and down the street, nobody driving. And you're like, what is going on here? Like we read about this stuff in the history books. Now we are the history book. People are going to be reading about this forever. And so it was hard. I'm really grateful to get out and travel again and get to the games, man. I've had a couple of conversations with people I haven't seen in 3 years. And it's just so nice to see them and go, oh, you're doing good. Great. Your family's good. I mean, it's energy. It's positive energy. It's nice to get.
How many different play-by-play people have you worked with this week or this year?
Well, let's see. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Tomorrow will be my 6th.
That's crazy.
So 5 at ESPN and I can't get away from Gord Miller. I mean, like, it's hard as I try to give him the left shoulder fake, but there he is. He's in the booth again. And so we've got 3 more games, Gord and I.
Yeah.
And then we lock into the World Junior tournament. So December 16th is our last game. And then we start exhibition games on the 19th and tournaments in Edmonton. And this year there'll be a bunch of people in there, which is great to see. And it's a fabulous tournament, but yeah, there's a different rhythm and a different cadence to everybody, the way they do the game. I've been upstairs, I've been downstairs, you know, so.
Is it on you to adapt to the caller, or is it the caller that has to adapt to the analyst?
I think it's more on me.
Yeah.
Because I've got to pick up what their cadence is and when they're going to lay out and maybe, you know, like I like to jump into the play while it's going on, but mm-hmm. maybe he or she doesn't do that.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they, you know, they continue on and I'm, so you, a couple times I catch myself with the old false start and then you're like, oh, I think that's okay. And then, you know, and then you just, once you start, you got to keep going and yeah. you're like, I hope he's listening and he's going to slow down. But
yeah,
it's so easy for me to work with Gord, you know, for years it was Chris Cuthbert too. And, you know, literally do, you know, 50 to 70 games a year with each of them. And so I could tell, oh, Chris is going to take, is going to lay out here. Oh, Gord's going to jump in here. It's easy. Yeah. When it's new all the time, you're kind of flying by the seat of your pants a little bit.
Is it cool to work with Sean?
Different.
Yeah.
You know why? He is so busy. I don't know how he keeps it straight. Like, I don't, honestly. Well, first week of the season, Red Sox are playing in the playoffs.
Yeah.
He's doing college football. So he came from, okay, so the Saturday, I want to say he was in either Norman or Lincoln. So, you know, there's not many direct flights out of there. And so He gets out of there on Saturday night, flies to Boston Sunday morning. The Red Sox play 15 innings in the playoffs, or 14 innings. He stays overnight, flies to Tampa. Now we got the first game of the season in Tampa. And so I, you know, I'm trying to help how I can, because his schedule is like, I think my schedule is busy. I do one sport.
Right.
So to watch, it's interesting to watch, like, how do you do that? Like, how do you compartmentalize your brain into going, yeah, okay, this is the football game. Yeah, forget about it. Well, there's 100 guys on his chart. Right. And like, how do you not mix up the names? Or it would be so easy to do. And the also the delivery of each sport is so different. Like football, play-by-play talks, guy gets tackled, analyst talks, 3 seconds to go before the play, play-by-play picks it up. It's like it's a format. Baseball, you can, I mean, Bob Uecker's been doing the games by himself for 50 years. You just tell stories, right? You, information and stories. Hockey is like in, out, in, out. It's so different. And it's really cool to watch him bounce between. Now, we'll get more consistent once the college football stops. You know, then we'll have the ABC games on Saturdays. And we'll probably have a game in the week, too. So it'll be way easier to build a cadence once we both get in the same city for a few games in a row.
I can just see that first game, you showing up, you're excited, like it's game one, and he's like, whoa.
Well, and then the other thing, so he's not been in any play-by-play booths, right? So he walks into the booth in Tampa, and you know the football booth is much bigger, and he's like, is this what the booths are like? I'm like, yeah, you know, I've never been in anything else, so no. I'm like, yeah, I guess so. I don't know. And he's like, oh, it's smaller than I thought. I'm like, I never even thought about it because I've never been in another one.
Right.
Right. So I mean, everything is different for a lot of the people that are back in hockey for the first time in 16, 17 years. It's so different for them each day. And us guys, we just go to the rink and you know where the door is, you know where the elevators are. You know, he's just, he, Steve Levy, Butchie, like all these guys, they're just getting it back together again. It's a lot.
Who's the best team in the National Hockey League right now?
I don't know. Well, I watched Tampa and Toronto tonight. Mm-hmm. They're at the top. Vegas is good. I mean, not because you're sitting there, but they're good. And they're doing it. I mean, I know we keep talking about Jack Eichel. When's Jack going to play? But man, they're missing Alec Martinez. Like, that is like 20-plus minutes of just, you don't even look at it. It's just done, finished.
Helps the power play, too.
Oh, just so simple and clean, everything that he does. And I think when he does that, that allow Pietrangelo to stop doing so much. He can settle in a little better. I mean, like he's playing crazy minutes and it's hard to do that all the time. I think Vegas is going to be one of the best. If Colorado's goaltending gets sorted in any fashion, holy smokes, can they score?
Yeah.
Like now, you know, MacKinnon got hit last night and he came back to the game. Bo Byram has had concussion problems and, you know, they got to be careful with him. They got to slow down the boat with him. But that team is really good. I don't see a scenario where somebody other than Vegas and Colorado play in the West.
Like it's because they're neither one's in a top three spot right now.
Yeah, and both of them for much the same reasons. Yeah, exactly. You know, like you look at them and you're like, yeah, that lineup or that record doesn't even mean anything. Not yet. Yeah. Carolina's very good.
I was impressed Carolina, when they came through.
You know what though, Daren? Like, I'm a big baseball guy. They remind me a little bit of the Atlanta Braves of the 90s, that over the long run, that team can beat anybody and beat them often. In a short series, do they have that extra gear that you have to find? And the Braves, I think they won 10 or 11 division titles in 12 years, and they won one World Series.
Right.
Like, they were built for the long haul, not the sprint. And that's a little bit how I I think about Carolina.
Who's your favorite pitcher of that rotation?
Tom Glavine.
Why?
I like lefties because I wasn't. I like that he could hit.
Did you ever throw lefty? Like just you ever screw around?
Wiffle ball. Oh, terrible. Terrible. The other thing though, if I think back to that, Greg Maddux threw 84 miles an hour for a decade. And the of course, no automatic strike zones then either. But so like he'd be an inch off the plate. Then a couple, pretty soon you couldn't have hit it with a boat oar. And they're like, strike three. Oh, he got the call there. He got the call. The guys would have had to run to the other side. He was so good. And the other thing, those guys didn't fool around. Get the ball, throw it. Let's move the game along. I loved those guys. That was a good team.
You should call baseball one day.
Like I would love that. That would be fun.
Cool.
Yeah, that would be fun. It's. I love baseball. When I had my knee replacement, in September of 2020, the playoffs were going on. So I'm stuck at home and I'm trying to rehab I was just out of surgery. So one day there was, I think there were 7 games on and I must've watched 60 innings. I just sat there and I was lying on my side watching and I'm like, I could watch this. I was going to say I could watch this all day. I did. I mean, there was nothing else to do.
You used to be able to score at will. Is that what Ovi's feeling right now?
Well, I don't know if he is, but he should. He's probably feeling he's getting something every night.
And differently, different ways.
Yeah. It doesn't even matter. But I'm amazed with how many assists he has too. Mm-hmm. He's got the 20 goals. The guy that's scoring at will right now is Austin Matthews. He's got a 7-game point streak or 7-game goal streak. Right. He's got goals in 7 straight games, 10 goals.
You ever do that?
Like, junior. Yeah. Like this, are you kidding me? Like, and it's just like so powerful. He's so fast. His shot is so good. He's a little bit like Ovi in the sense that he's now scoring closer and closer to the net. And you're like, if you can score from 35 feet and now you're figuring out how to score at 5 feet, where are you stopped? Right. Who's going to stop this? I think even though he's behind, I think Matthews is going to win the Rocket.
You do?
Yeah. He's got 17 goals. Yeah. Everybody else has got 21. Like, big deal. You get that in a weekend. These guys, the best shooters, like, Ovi's been the best shooter for the last 15 years. Like, whoever else you think is really good and doing on all that thing, Ovi's the best. And Matthews is right there. Their release is just staggering to watch.
Why I love connecting with you is when you say, you answer something like, I'm totally out of my mind.
No.
17 goals. I like that. I like that. Oh. That's great.
I look at these guys and I'm like, they can all go hot. Like Dreisaitl did early. Man, he was getting 2 points a game. You're like, how do they do that for 4 games, for 18 games? And they can all run really hot. Right now, Matthews is really hot. And by Christmas, I think that race is all gummed up and you're going to go, it's a toss up.
We got to let you go, but say hi to Stammer tonight when you see him. Cause I think he might be on the Olympic team.
Yeah. Okay. How about this little stat we came across? He hasn't scored in 2 straight games. Mm-hmm. Hasn't gone 3 games without a goal this year. He looks like Stamkos of 5 years ago.
Yes.
He's skating. His skating is so easy. As opposed to, he looked like he was kind of like fighting it all the time. And, you know, he doesn't need 5 shots to score. So it'd be interesting to see if, you know, here he is at game 3. Does he jump right back in and get another? And they're doing it without Kucherov and Point. They're scoring more goals without Braden Point than they were with him, which doesn't make any sense.
Vegas did the same thing with all their injuries. They were averaging the same number of goals as they did last year. I don't know how.
Yeah, you know what? You know what Vegas has got when Jack Eichel shows up? I think they have the best, I can't think of any, best 1-2-3 center punch in the game.
Yeah.
I that's going to be hard to compete with because all of a sudden, like, is William Karlsson your third center? Jeez, that's pretty good. Yeah. What about, I remember doing, we had Pacioretty on our podcast, Daren, and he said, who surprised you in Vegas since you got there? like that. He said, Chandler Stevenson. He said, I had no idea. And I'm like, that guy is good.
And he led the team in points without the two big boys.
Yes. So now you got Eichel, Stevenson, Carlson.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
I don't even try and get it to Vegas. It always ends up back in Vegas.
Yeah, because everybody loves Vegas. Everybody loves Vegas.
Are you going to come and visit us? Do you have any Vegas games?
Oh, yes, I do. I've got Toronto on like January 11th or 12th, maybe the 12th. Okay. And then in March, I've got somebody is at Vegas. I'm a little foggy on the opposition, but there will be another team there.
Here's my question that I wanted to ask at the start. Do you talk to people on planes or do you put the earplugs in and crash out?
Depends. I don't want to talk about my job all the time. So if somebody's peppering me with questions, I tend to ask what they do. And I ask another question. And then funny, they don't want to talk about what they do either. So some guy that's, a medical salesman. I'm like, oh, so how do you do? And which parts do you sell? And pretty soon the answers are getting shorter and shorter. I will say this though. The other day I'm flying to Winnipeg. And I'm doing my charts for the game the next day. And this woman sitting beside me goes, oh, I recognize those names. She goes, I don't mean to be looking over your shoulder, or I'm not looking over your shoulder, but I recognize those names. And I said, well, actually you are looking over my shoulder, aren't you? And she started to laugh, right? She's a season ticket holder in Winnipeg. The long answer to this is we ended up talking for about 30 minutes because she was like right on top of it. Gee, Morrissey's been better this year. I think he's got a new partner. Dylan has added some size. And I was like, oh my God, she was really interesting to talk to.
And were you writing stuff down?
Yeah, I took a couple of notes, stole them, used them in the game. In broadcasting, if you can't think of it, just steal it. And then you're in business.
Yeah, and you only have to really give credit to the stuff that you're not 100% sure on. Because if you're wrong, then you can blame that person that you stole it from. Like,
oh yeah, no, but I don't think I could say, a lady told me this on a plane. I think I'd probably need to do a little more research than that.
Have fun tonight and have fun with that Sid Ovi game. Yeah. With a lot of people listening to it, we'll know the score and the result, but considering you've been doing this for 20 years to be doing that combination is pretty neat.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. It's it will be fun. And the fact that both guys are rolling right now makes it really good too. So looking forward to doing it and then tidying up for the World Juniors.
And enjoy that you and Gord, another epic bubble adventure.
Yes, well, we'll try and make it through safe. Merry Christmas to everybody, eh? Have
you
a great
too.
Christmas, Daren.
You
we'll
too,
see
buddy.
You in January.